Perhaps you'd say a few words on how you got into anthropology as well.
Well, I didn't get into anthropology really. I got into Maori studies to begin with. And that was because as a boy, I had been brought up very largely in the country. You know, went to school barefoot and rode a horse and this kind of thing. And had, I think, over the years got some feeling for New Zealand and the country and the people and so on. And by accident, I've recorded it somewhere, I went to a bookshop and found a copy of Manning's Old New Zealand. And this was an extremely exciting book to read to me then, a boy of 14. Started to learn more about the Maori in the public library. I read rather incomprehensible articles on the Journal of Polynesian Society, and I began to learn Maori a bit later on from a Maori, James Rukutai, who was a Waikato man, and gradually, as it were, read myself into Maori studies and had some acquaintance with Maori people. And then, on one or two occasions, we made trips into the countryside, which we often did otherwise, and one particular, I went with a couple of friends of mine down the Whakataina River, staying at Maori settlements and so on. And so I built up a kind of general knowledge of Maori society and Maori beliefs and customs, and then turned in the direction of more theoretical anthropology. And that was in part due, I think, to Lowy's Primitive Society. I was given a copy of Lowy's Primitive Society, and that showed me the wider comparative bearings of Maori studies. But I'd also been reading River's History of Melanesian Society and found a number of things to object to even then on theoretical grounds. So I suppose I had some kind of more personal bent towards anthropology.
Raymond, at that time in New Zealand, were there any Maori studies or anthropology in the universities?
Oh, not at all. The subject, I suppose, was hardly conceived of, even by university authorities. I think there was one ethnologist, that was H.T. Skinner, who had a museum position in Otago, and he gave a few lectures connected with his subject, which was primarily that of material culture and technology in Otago, but otherwise there was no anthropology even thought of in those days. In fact, I read economics as one of my main subjects in my first degree, and then decided, although I did very badly in the examination because we were all marked by J.M. Keynes, I decided to continue in economics and did a master's degree, which was the honours degree of those days. And I did again something a little unusual. I decided to do a dissertation. I think the only MA thesis that had been written so far in economics in New Zealand was by Copeland, and that was on the wheat industry. And that stimulated me to think, well, I might do something of my own. So I did it on the kauri gum industry. And kauri gum, as you know, is this fossil resin, which in those days was used better qualities for varnish, poorer qualities for linoleum. So I did mainly a library piece of work on that, but in order to get certain kinds of information about income and working conditions, I found I actually had to go on the gum fields themselves. And this was in a sense, although I didn't realize it then, a kind of proto-anthropological field work, because I had to move around from one gum field to another, where these people are living in very simple conditions, you know, sacking shacks and that kind of thing. And talk to them about their relations with storekeepers by whom previously they'd been exploited, and the general earnings that they got and that kind of thing. Wrote that up, and in the end that was published in an abridged form by the government printer. And it was after that that I went to England and read
anthropology. You went to England specifically to read anthropology?
No, I went to England to read economics. And as Maurice Friedman always used to laugh at this, he dug out somewhere or other the fact that I had as one of my possibilities a study of the meat industry, frozen meat industry, New Zealand. But the man dealing with commodities was not there when I got there. And I'd always thought that I would take some lectures in anthropology as a kind of hobby. Seligman happened to be there. I went in, and Seligman said, let me introduce you to Dr. Malinowski. And I'd come across Malinowski's book a year or so before and been fascinated by it, because he'd done what I had vaguely thought I might do, and that is bring together anthropology and economics. And here was this Argonauts of the Western Pacific, which was an absolutely superb, fascinating essay in this. So I met Malinowski and Seligman and said that I would like to do some anthropology as a hobby, although I have to read economics as a main professional interest, because I thought, returning to New Zealand, that was the only thing that I could work in. So for 6 months I sat on the fence, really, between economics and anthropology, and then decided, oh, the hell with it, decided I'd do the degree in anthropology and not in a kind of anthropological economics.
And this is what became the Economics of New Zealand Māori?
That's what became Economics of the New Zealand Māori, which I finished just before I left for the field and took my doctorate with Julian Pedruva's father as the external examiner.
So what year did you come to London, and what year did you in fact leave for?
I came to London in 1924, and I left, returning to New Zealand in 1927. I spent a few months back home, and then went off to the Solomons and Tikapia in 1928.
And that was financed from London, that fieldwork?
No, it was financed by the Australian National Research Council, because Radcliffe Brown had moved fairly recently from South Africa, was chairman of the Anthropology Research Council, and was then busily engaged in getting field workers to work mainly in Australia, but to some extent in the Pacific. And so he had Lloyd Warner in Northern Australia, Elkin, he helped get into the field, and I to Tikapia, Hobin went to Rennell Island and later to Ontonjava. But also, Radcliffe Brown needed a lecturer, because Deacon, who had been appointed as his lecturer, Bernard Deacon, from Cambridge, died in fieldwork on Malekula. And so, through, I suppose, Malinowski and Radcliffe Brown, I was appointed lecturer in the department at Sydney. But before I took up the lectureship, it was agreed I'd do a year of field research on Tikapia. As a matter of fact, Rennell had been my first choice, or as an alternative, but what I wanted was a Polynesian society which was in those days relatively untouched by civilization. And Rennell was one, Tikapia was another. But there had been a rumor that phosphate might have been discovered on Rennell Island, an elevated coral atoll. And so Radcliffe Brown took the opportunity of a geological expedition going there to St. Hobin. So I went to Tikapia.
Can we go back perhaps to your first 3 years in London with Malinowski and Seligman? And this presumably was the time which Malinowski was just starting to become a world figure in anthropology and to some extent to dominate the anthropological scene. What was he like in these earlier years?
Oh, very, intellectually very attractive. A man of terrific personality. I think everywhere he went, he created a very definite impression. You know, this rather tall, pale-faced Pole with large spectacles, a very precise way of speaking. He never completely mastered English. He spoke English and he wrote it beautifully, of course, and he spoke English extremely well. And he had Rajesh Setharis somewhere on the shelves. But he always said things like food instead of food and so on, which he was teased about. But his seminars, which he was just beginning in, were fascinating. So Evans Pritchard, Ashley Montague as he is now, I, Barbara Aitken, who'd been Barbara Freer-Marico and worked among the Tewa, Ursula Grant Duff, the daughter of old Lord Avery. This was the sort of first group. And then
that
we
was
were
the
joined
nucleus for the first seminar.
Yes, and then we were joined a year or so later by Hortense Powdermaker, by Shapira, and so on.
You just mentioned this seminar, in the beginning of Malinowski's seminar, and some of the people who were there. I gather the young students of the growing subject of anthropology had a pretty intense student life in London of those days.
Well, there were, on the whole, fewer of us, and London academically was very different. For example, Soho, which is where we used to go a lot, was a rather pleasant foreign colony in London, not that sleazy, very unpleasant place it is now. And we used to meet quite a lot in Old Compton Street, a cafe on the corner, Cafe Torino, I think it was, or something of the kind, and go to restaurants and pubs in Soho. In fact, I remember on one occasion, we'd just had dinner, we were walking along Old Compton Street and heard the sounds of music coming from upstairs, so we walked up the stairs, found we'd walked into an Italian workers' club, and they received us in a very friendly way, and we danced with them, and they said, come again, which of course we didn't ever do, but there, and we used to dine at one or two Chinese restaurants. There was a Bologna restaurant where you got an admirable seven-course dinner for, I think, 3 and 6 pence. And we had that kind of student life. We would go on walks very often out to Leith Hill and Guildford area and so on. And then we went on the continent together to some extent. That was stimulated by Malinowski's living in Oberbozen, in his villa there, what is now the Alto Adige, North Tyrol, North Italy, with still very strong remnants of its Austrian former belonging. And a number of his graduate students went over there from time to time. We lived in the priest's house. He had a magnificent cook, and we would go along to Malinowski's for anthropological discussion, which was pretty intensive. In fact, the story, I've written it somewhere before, I think, Lucy Mayer going to walk down to Bautzen, which is about 1,500 feet down in the valley, and Malinowski saying to her, ah, yes, and what problem are you going to think about on the way down?
Well, at this time, too, I believe your New Zealand country upbringing was somewhat modified by Evans Pritchard and other of the students, I believe. In fact, you were introduced to some vices in the London of this time.
Well, if you call alcohol a vice, it depends on the point of view, doesn't it? I know the story that you are aiming at, and that is, I think, the first time I dined out. Evans Pritchard and I were very good friends, and we've always remained on, at any rate, a sort of overt level of friendship, although I think sometimes underneath it there were various elements of power struggle involved. But I think he took me to dine at the L'Escargot, the old Escargot, just south of Old Compton Street, and produced a bottle of wine. And I had a little and stopped after about the first glass. I said, first time I'd drunk wine. And Evans Pritchard, rather grumblingly, said, well, I have to finish the whole bottle myself, which I think he did quite successfully.
I'm sure.
But we had, it was a very interesting time, I think, because the people in the broad spectrum included, for example, Dryburg, who had just come back from a rather dramatic period in the Sudan, where he'd resigned his post because he had fabricated a tribal war in order to avoid a real one he didn't believe in. There was the girl who afterwards became his wife, Pearl Binder, the artist, who later remarried and is now Lady Elwyn Jones, the wife of the Lord Chancellor. There was Victor de la Haya de la Torre, who was a Peruvian refugee, and who was the founder of Aprista, the Peruvian Socialist Party, led a very checkered career. I remember we were in Paris, a whole group of us then, with Victor de la Haya de la Torre, Pearl Binder and others, rowing on the Bois de Boulogne and that sort of thing, Hortense Powdermaker. And I think the transition from England to the continent, as we called it then, was a very easy one.
At this time, anthropology was barely recognized as a university subject. It was just winning its spurs, as it were.
In Britain?
In Britain.
Merritt was at Oxford as a reader, and Haddon as a reader in Cambridge. I think, and I don't like to trust my memory, but I think the only chair was that of Fraser at Liverpool, and that was not very effective as a teaching device. Both Merritt and Haddon, of course, had students, but I remember Evans Pritchard telling me how shocked Merritt was when he, Evans Pritchard, decided to leave Oxford and go to London to study. He said, "Raymond, you've no idea what it means for an Oxford man to leave Oxford and go to London." And I think that is a kind of index of the difference between the academic climate of those days and the climate now, when people do really move from one university to another. But you didn't have, of course, anything like the profusion of the so-called red brick universities. And nor were Oxford and Cambridge considered as quite so provincial as sometimes they are nowadays.
And how are all these students financed?
Mainly by their own resources. There were hardly any scholarships or studentships of that kind. I mean, I lived, for example, on £250 a year, which my father was good enough to provide. And I supplemented it a little in the last year or so. And Evans Pritchard had his own finances. Hortense, I'm not sure about. Shapira may have had a scholarship from South Africa, but they were few. And it was only with the institution of the Australian National Research Council that anthropology in this part of the world really began to take off, as it were.
Well, this brings us to your Tikapia field trip, which was financed by the National Research Council. Perhaps you could say something about the sort of conditions, fieldwork conditions, of your first trip. You have written about it, I know, but...
Well, I've written so much in a way that I feel rather shy about going into more detail, as it were. But it was then, of course, a really remote island, and the whole aspect of strangeness was very much before one. I had, through my knowledge of Maori, got a fair working knowledge of what Tikapia grammar would be. And in fact, quite a lot of Tikapia vocabulary was either identical with Maori or very close to it. Vai, as against Maori, wai, for water. Sare, as against Maori, hare, for walk, and so on. And I was able, first of all, through the help of the Melanesian Mission, which had then some influence in Tikapia, I was able to use their so-called school for the first month or so as a dwelling. I then had a house built on one side of the island, and later I went over and lived in an older house. And I think I've recorded somewhere how the graves of the father and the grandfather of the owner were just beside my bed, and one was asked not to sit on them, generally abuse them, as it were. And that was really the Tikapia of those days. But I enjoyed the experience enormously. I found the people very hospitable, and I think it was there that I realized the significance of rhythm in dance.
You talk of isolation of Tikapia then. How long were you on the island after being deposited there, as it were, before anybody visited the game?
Oh, they had the Southern Cross in those days, which is a 400-ton steam yacht, and she called again after 3 months with some further supplies. She was supposed to call again in 7 months later, but she didn't come for another 9 months later because she broke her rudder at Norfolk and had to be repaired and so on. So altogether, I was on the island for 12 months. The last part of it was 9 months in...
And there was no way you could communicate, no radio link or anything of those?
Not in the sort. The Tikapia were very reassuring because, you see, when the Southern Cross didn't come at the end of 7 months, I had all my stuff packed because, she would call and then go.
Yeah.
So I had to have everything packed up, and she didn't come. and she kept on not coming. And I would go and look every now and again around the horizon, nothing happened. And the ticket payer said, oh, don't you worry. I mean, she may have gone to the bottom, but you're all right. You're a safe on man. What are you worrying about?
I believe since that initial visit, you have maintained extensive contact with ticket payer.
Yes. For many years, of course, there was no contact. They couldn't write, and I had no way really of communicating effectively. But I went back in 1952 with James Spilius as my research assistant, and in 1966 with Torben Monberg as a colleague for a short period, and I was back again among Tikapir, although not on Tikapir, in 1973, staying with a Tikapir friend of mine, and recently I've had him over in Auckland working on this Tikapir lexicon, this dictionary that I've been engaged on for the last 5 or 6 years. And I've also kept up correspondence in varying degree with people on Tikapir and Tikapir elsewhere in the Solomons. It's a very great change from 50 years ago, or indeed 30 or 40 years ago.
Then at the end of your Tikapir fieldwork, you went to Sydney to take up the post in the newly, or fairly newly founded Department of Anthropology there.
Yes, that was in 1930. And Radcliffe Brown, of course, was by then well established. He had Lloyd Warner out there, going up and down to Arnhem Land. Camilla Wedgwood was with him for a year, lecturing in the position which I was to take up later on. And Radcliffe Brown, of course, led a very active social life, so I gather. Before I came, he was a frequent visitor to Government House, and was among the white tie social set, as it were. But after I got there, partly I think his Government House contacts had changed, and there was a small group that formed with him as a very prominent member, based on a restaurant in King's Cross, where we dined nearly every evening, the Claremont Cafe. The owners of it were Swiss, and our group consisted, apart from Radcliffe Brown and myself, of a Swiss wool buyer, Herman Adam, who's remained a good friend of mine ever since, of a Russian girl who afterwards married Victor Tukogis, who became the professor of biochemistry in Melbourne, who were also good friends of mine still. We spent Christmas with them. And a number of other people, mostly European, and we had parties in each other's houses. Radcliffe Brown was living at the time in the old Oxford Hotel, which is very near the Queen's Club in Sydney, and he had the ballroom of the hotel as his main sitting room. And I remember one occasion where Radcliffe Brown recently returned from Java, from I think the Pan-Pacific Pacific Science Congress, giving a display of Javanese dancers, bare to the waist with a Javanese sarong, and doing the various movements. And we danced there, and we visited the wine cellars of Leo Buring, who made Kreltar Lahock in those days.
Still does.
And it was an intellectual life and an aesthetic life. Caroline Tennant and her husband Timothy Kelly was then running a little theatre at which we appeared a great deal. I remember being judge of some local plays, rather to my surprise. This was, I think it's relevant anthropologically in a way, because most people's lives are shaped in part by the non-professional contacts that they have, and I'm quite sure that in my case, these non-professional contacts with people in the whole spectrum, as it were, of other interests, have been in part responsible for shaping my own ideas.
And in Sydney, it sounds as if your social group was very much more non-professional, as it were, compared to London, or is it just to emphasise that aspect?
Of necessity, then, yes, because the number of graduate students in anthropology in London grew, whereas in Sydney, the number of graduate students was not large at that time. And moreover, Sydney, a much smaller intellectual circle than in London, meant for a different kind of made for a different kind of arrangement.
And then Radcliffe Brown, hearing the call elsewhere, left you as professor, I believe.
Well, hearing the call is perhaps a nice way of putting it. In fact, what happened was a financial blizzard came, the Great Depression, and the states, who previously had been supporting the chair of anthropology in Sydney, partly, I think, on the ground that somehow or other it was to be good for the general administrative education, they began to withdraw their support. And so the future of the chair in Sydney was threatened at the same time as Rattrapan was offered a quite attractive appointment as professor in Chicago. So in the middle of 1931, he left for Chicago, and I was left as acting professor of anthropology, acting editor of Oceania, acting chairman of the Anthropology Committee of the Australian National Research Council. And that's when Piddington and Phyllis Cabery and others came, so to speak, under my immediate jurisdiction.
You were acting professor, but didn't have a professor's salary, is that it? Or?
They gave me a half professor's salary, and I've forgotten now exactly about the business about appointment. I think I might perhaps have stayed, but Malinowski then came with an offer for me to go as lecturer. And although the salary differential was very considerable, and I dropped a very considerable salary, nevertheless, I felt that returning to London was the thing I really wanted to do. So I went back as lecturer to Malinowski. And then in 1936, the year in which Rosemary and I married, I became a reader.
So you will return to London and to the London School of Economics, where you are, of course, chiefly associated and with the London School of Economics in the anthropological world at the moment, and as the successor of Malinowski. What was the change in the London School of Economics scene in your Malinowski position in the session?
Yes, Malinowski, when I first knew him, that was 1924 onwards through 27, was still, I think, becoming known in the anthropological world. It was quite clear he was a man of very great intellectual force. And, of course, he'd been around the London School of Economics one way and another since about 1910. But he was establishing himself theoretically with the functional method, which he was still working out. And I was his research assistant, 1925-26, for a year or so. But when I got back there in 1933, he'd become very much the professor. And the department was much larger. His seminars were getting, I suppose, internationally known. And so the ordinary students probably didn't see as much of him as we did in the 1920s and then in the 1920s.
What this change, the professor implies a certain authoritarian view?
Not so much authoritarian, because I think one of the things about Malinowski was his attempt always to bring out whatever it was in the ideas of the people he was talking with. Not so much he wanted to impose his own ideas. If you like, he wanted to seduce you into his ideas. And I think he was very human in these respects. And he, I think, was very sensitive to anything that he regarded as rejection and so on. But not so much authoritarian, I think, as rather more remote from his students. He had, by that time, a much wider intellectual influence and was asked to do all kinds of lecturing jobs, and he was advisory on many things, was consulted. He'd been to America, and therefore, I think the general circumstances had changed. Anthropology was much more recognized as an academic discipline of some significance.
And the department had presumably grown in staff, apart from yourself and Malinowski.
Oh yes, we began to add to it at various times. Fortis, Audrey Richards, Margaret Reed were all lecturing there.
And you had undergraduate teaching as well as...
Undergraduate teaching, there were not many undergraduates, but undergraduate teaching had assumed some significance. There had been degrees, first degrees in anthropology, for a very long time, but they were anthropology of the broad, generalized type, physical, material culture, archaeology and so on. In fact, when I first began to lecture there, I was taking sailormen's place to some extent, and I gave very effective courses on stone implements. In fact, I was rather put out because I gathered from the students, since they were very well illustrated, that they rather preferred the courses on prehistory to those on social anthropology that I gave. But I've forgotten now even what a burin or a graver looks like.
But Malinowski saw himself as the founder, very definitely, of anthropology as a social science with an emphasis on the
very definitely, and in fact he and Seligman, I think, parted to some extent on that particular issue. Seligman is very much of the old school in that respect, whereas Malinowski was essentially, from all his intellectual upbringing, I think, a social anthropologist and sociologist. And Seligman, on the other hand, used to say, well, I leave the social stuff to Brenda. But Seligman, of course, had his own perceptions. In some ways, he anticipated, I think, a lot of the modern interest in the technological and aesthetic connections between, say, the West and China.
Yes, he also had, he certainly didn't ignore the social material, and he had a very broad view of anthropology, which, yes, to some extent, Malinowski's specialization narrowed out.
I think that's true, and to some extent, of course, it was there was another kind of division, and that was Evans Pritchard was very definitely, as an Africanist, Seligman's man, whereas I, not an Africanist, was Malinowski's man, and this, in a sense, just exemplified the kind of division that there was.
Well, we're on.
Well, Rosemary, we have to get you in, you see, because we've just reached the point where Raymond said he was promoted to reader and married Rosemary. I think it was in the other order, he said.
Look, it just occurred to me, and that is a word about salaries in those days. When I was lecturing in Sydney at first, I got £300 a year. And when I became acting professor, I got £900 a year. And when I became a reader, I've forgotten what I got as lecturer, but as a reader, I got £600 a year in London. And on that, we lived reasonably well, didn't we?
After you were established in London as a reader, you married Rosemary. Presumably you saw your career staying in London to a large extent. I believe you looked around for a possible second fieldwork area.
Yes, indeed. We had thought of going to the field in 1938, but Malinowski turned out to have leave that year, and so we delayed it till 1939. But we were prepared originally to go to China, and for 6 months or so we used the Linguaphone series on Chinese and attained a mild fluency in Mandarin. But then the Japanese had started, they had invaded Shandong, which is where we intended to go, and they also had started their southward drive from Canton. So it didn't seem to be a good idea to do anthropology in the van of an advancing army, so we turned to Malaya. But we'd had all these contacts with Fei Shaotung, who'd been in London, and with Wu Wentzhao, who also came to London. And it had gone quite some way in field plan.
So you changed your field then to another area of Japanese interest, but luckily the Japanese didn't arrive until after you'd completed.
We got there first, and Rosemary and I, with Winstead, learnt a certain amount of Malay to start us off.
In fact, war was declared about 6 weeks after we arrived in Malaya, and many people I understand abroad and in the field hastened home with patriotic motives and wasted their time waiting for there to be something to do. But Raymond, perhaps being rather tougher, decided that we would sit quiet and see. So we in fact did fulfill our 1 year's field work situation and only returned to England in 1940, just before the Japanese invaded Malaysia.
Yes, there was some talk of a Japanese invasion, but nobody took it very seriously. We had a Nuffield grant, and I wrote to Carl Saunders and said, as Rosemary has mentioned, that he didn't seem to be very likely to return to England, so we stayed put.
Rosemary, you were a trained anthropologist when you went to Malaysia.
No, I was not a trained anthropologist, and in fact it's possible to say that I am not still a trained anthropologist. I suppose because of my personality, or because of the fact that it's very difficult, I think, to be married to an anthropologist unless you've got either something of your own very different to do, or you do work with him. I went to Malinowski's seminars at the London School of Economics as a kind of observer and outsider. I wasn't asked to write papers, and he never turned on me, as he had a habit of doing with those devastating questions.
She was given the respect due to an affine, you see.
I see. But you hadn't, in fact, dabbled in anthropology until you met and married Raymond, is that right?
I dabbled in the sociological sciences, and in my degree at Edinburgh, which actually was in economics, as Raymond's was, but it was called political economy in those days, I read Durkheim and Marx and other such people.
But in your fieldwork in Malaysia, you took a very definite part and indeed conducted your own research. You weren't by any means merely an assistant to Raymond.
Yes, I learnt to be an anthropologist by being an apprentice to Raymond, I suppose it's fair to say.
And I didn't look at it like that, I must say.
In fact, it's a very good way to learn fieldwork, to do it with someone who is so much more experienced.
Do you know, Anthony, that article of Rosemary's, Wife into Anthropologist and the Crossing Cultural Boundaries?
Yes, I've seen it. Well, what you in fact concentrated on Malay women, I believe.
I concentrated on Malay women, and I think that it's a reasonable and sensible thing for a woman to do if she's in the field with a male partner. And sometimes it saddens me that women who go into the field today because of their ideas about equality between the sexes and so forth wish to concentrate on any theoretical problem, the same as a man may do, and won't always look at the problems of women, which after all in field situations it is becoming clear perhaps only a woman can do, so that I'm glad I did it, and I don't think in a Muslim country it would have been easy for Raymond to have done some of the work in the women's houses that I did.
Oh, it would have been impossible.
No. Raymond, your work continued in the economic stream, as it were, at a more complex type of society from the ones you previously looked at, but your initial concentration, at least, was on the economic side.
Mine entered.
In Malaya, yes.
Yes, I was concerned primarily with production and marketing in the fishing field, and Rosemary with the women's side of the domestic economy and the like. But of course we did a lot of other things besides economic.
Yeah.
We did spend a lot of time in spirit medium performance situations, and we attended Wayankulit shows and all that kind of thing, and it was an interesting aesthetic experience as well as an anthropological experience, wouldn't you say, Rosemary?
Yes, if I think of this one experience in my life which has changed my whole attitude to other things, it's the field experience, I'm sure that is so, and to my mind that is partly what, no, to my mind that is mainly what being an anthropologist is. It is having been forced in the field to gain a new way of looking at things, a new perspective, and then to come back to the ordinary life and see one's own life in the same way. To me that is essential to anthropological experience, and I don't see how when we're talking about teaching anthropology to people who haven't got the privilege of going into the field, we can really do it in more than a very partial manner.
I think that, you know, the things that are written about colonialist anthropology about the essentially Western viewpoint and conceptualizations of the anthropologist, these very often miss the point of what Rosemary, for instance, has been saying, that most of the older anthropologists were really very much absorbed into the local life of the people, and to a considerable extent, I think, did submit themselves to the ideas discipline of rules of the society in which they entered.
Indeed. Change the emphasis slightly. I mean, you have, most of your work, Raymond, has been, most of your fieldwork has been oriented towards economic or more general anthropological considerations, yet you've always had, right from your early interest in Maoris, a great interest in artistic activity and in art, carving and painting more specifically. I know that in my own case it was through your support that I was enabled to go and study art as a proper subject. Would it be true to say that it would not have been considered a proper subject for a piece of fieldwork in your day?
I think it would have been regarded as extremely idiosyncratic, and I wouldn't say altogether an improper subject, but it was very much on the fringe. And I think that many anthropologists have not really had any particular interest in art. Evans Pritchard, for example, as I remember, never displayed any particular interest in graphic art or in music, although in the more literary field he had quite a great sensitivity, and I think I remember him saying, wrote poetry, although no trace of it seems to have been found. Of course, what interests me very much, and always has been music. And I still keep the interest in early music, as Rosemary and indeed our son Hugh have.
It probably would have been rather more difficult to get funds for research on such matters in those days than today, would it not?
Yes, I think that would have been regarded as a study in art and not in anthropology. Of course, there were studies of primitive art, as it was called in those days, and you know very well, of course, the literature on that. But I think the great difference has been that the translation from specimen to art object has opened up a whole new field of interesting anthropological studies, of which yours, I think, is outstanding. But the old idea that all this ethnography was just specimen militated against any recognition by the wider authorities of such an aesthetic study as a proper part of anthropology. It would have been regarded as philosophical or much more general.
You also have, as you went back to Tikapia, you've also both, I believe, been back to Malaya. Perhaps you'd like to say something about your return there.
Yeah, that was an extraordinary experience for me, and I think for both of us, a good emotional experience and also a very interesting academic experience. You get something from going back for a very reasonable time. We were there, 3 months?
Barely
3 months. But you get a chance to check up on census, population, and to ask some questions which you hadn't thought of asking before.
But considerable changes had taken place.
Oh, the dimension of change was very great indeed. I think we were faced when we returned by a depressed fishing industry, whereas before it had been a very live fishing industry. The power had been transferred really from local entrepreneurs to entrepreneurs back in the major cities, and therefore in that sense things were very different. On the other hand, domestically and even in terms of belief and local ritual, we found very much to build upon.
But in the artistic sphere, there were some sad losses due, I suppose, to poverty. They didn't decorate their boats so beautifully. They didn't go out to sea in coloured sails, with coloured sails. And they didn't have, I think, so many, why don't call it, performances. As they used to do.
Yes, of course there was the constant struggle against Islam, because the local peasantry had their own solution. That is, they said Islam can cater for a certain range of human difficulties, but underneath this, some of the old gods and so on are still useful, whereas, of course, the Orthodox wouldn't have any of it, and therefore there was this continual attrition, as it were, of peasant belief and practice.
What about your personal relations when you returned? You were undoubtedly welcomed, but...
Yes, we were welcomed in a very strange way. That is, people would come up to us, people whom we didn't recognize, and I remember a woman coming up and peering into my face and saying, "Yes, don't you remember me? I'm sorry." And she'd become old and thin, and I didn't recognize her, and she went on talking, and then rather like a photograph developing under your eyes as she spoke and as she explained who she was and talked, then suddenly, "Oh yes, of course, I do remember you." And that's quite a moving experience, and I suppose it happened to them. They also, by the way, some of them were not sure, perhaps less sure who I was than whom Raymond was, and looked at me. After all, it was 25 years later, and I was a good deal older, and they looked at me and said to Raymond, "Is she the same wife, or have you got a new one?"
That reminds us of a hilarious evening we had earlier when we had a discussion on polygamy. And we'd been discussing the difficulties when you had more than one wife of keeping it all going and so on. And they said, you know, how do people manage in Britain, in England, you see? And when we said, "Oh, if you marry more than one wife, you get put in jail," they roared with laughter. This was obviously an extraordinary joke. And the interesting thing is, Rosemary and I both felt at that moment, as we confessed to each other later, how it did seem odd to put somebody in jail for what, in a Muslim country, was regarded as an ordinary social procedure.
Well, Raymond, to finish up, would you like to say something about the developments that have taken place in anthropology and social anthropology during your career? You started as an anthropologist associated with both Malinowski and Radcliffe Brown, who between them, I suppose, must be regarded as the founders, at least in England, of anthropology as a social science, in capital letters. And you remain prominent and active right to this moment, so there is nobody better, I feel, to give an overview of what has happened in anthropology than yourself.
Well, leaving all the adjectives aside, what has impressed me, I think, has been the development from functional concepts through structural concepts to concepts of process. And I rather flatter myself that I've had something to do with the change in interest from structure to process. Although my own ideas about social organization have, I think, been too diffuse to be of any very direct value there. Nevertheless, it's part of a general process in which I've been interested to be involved. I also, of course, notice very much how ideas of cultural determinism have faded. And with that fading, I'm very much in sympathy. What also strikes me is the replacement of the very general what questions, how questions, which we had principally before us, by why questions. And I think that the why questions now can be asked and to some extent answered because of the mass of materials accumulated through the earlier how and what questions.
And what other respects do you see the enormous broadening of the profession? I mean, both in numbers and to some extent in the subject matter. Malinowski and Radcliffe Brown have contracted the subject matter of classical anthropology to focus on social structures. This has broadened out to symbolic and other things.
I think that the earlier kinds of association were of a rather artificial type, as it were. The modern kinds of association between the biological studies, the prehistoric and archaeological studies, much more closely integrated. And that, I think, is obviously a good development. What another kind of development that I'm not quite so sure about is this feeling of uncertainty in the propositions that anthropologists put forward. The tendency at one extreme, of course, to go in for an almost mystical approach. At the other extreme, to focus on the highly individual character of any anthropologist's findings. And this, I think, does open the whole question of universality, of generalization, of abstraction, of comparability. And I think this will always remain, presumably, a field of argument because of the different commitments, intellectual and emotional, of the anthropologist concerned. But I think there are quite deep issues that have got to be continually re-tackled, if you might think of it.
You see a cyclical development to some extent, do you?
Spiral rather than cyclical, I think, is the metaphor that one would use.